The light just went out. I pushed the record button. This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 401, AREDN Incorporated. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and today Darren's back.
Hey, everyone.
Say hi, Darren.
Hi.
Darren AJ6BL. And we have remotely a guest today, Randy Smith, WU2S. Is that right?
No, not quite. Whiskey Uniform 2 Sierra.
Yes, Whiskey Uniform 2 Sierra from AREDN. So welcome, Randy. Thank you for joining us today. And
thanks for having me, David.
Oh, you're really welcome. You're really welcome. I've actually played around a little bit with AREDN, but nowhere near enough to be able to say I have anything connected to anything other than the two nodes at the opposite end of my garage. So I'm hoping you could educate us a little bit and tell us about what's going on with AREDN, the changes, and where it's going. So let's dig right in.
Sounds good. Well, happy to do so. And I think your example is just fine, David. It's where almost all of us started and where people are starting today, with two nodes in the garage or across the basement or just in the back of their office somewhere, just to see how things work and convince themselves that, in fact, a very high-speed, reliable RF-based IP network is, in fact, feasible, and it works, and you can do it.
Excellent, excellent. So AREDN was a spin-off of the, I'm going to get it wrong,
High-speed multimedia, yes. Broadband hamnet.
Broadband hamnet. And I played around with that a little bit as well. And somewhere in the box, there's some old Linksys routers.
Yeah, I got a WRT54 sitting around
We all have boxes full of those sitting around. And that was a great start. I mean, that was a tremendous effort that the folks put in into that and actually turned those old blue and black Linksys boxes into something pretty darn remarkable, and folks were actually using those out in the field. In fact, I put a number of them in some sealed buckets and had external antennas back in 2013, and got them to work. And it was fine as far as it went, but it was time to move on from there, and that's ultimately what we did.
Yeah, and so I guess at some point you guys decided that there was a need or a reason to branch out and find some more powerful hardware?
Well, that's part of it, sure. The Linksys boxes, even when we started using them, were fairly long in the tooth, almost obsolete at that point, even though they worked just fine at home indoors. But they were clearly not made to work outdoors. There was much better weatherproof commercial equipment that was readily available at very affordable costs. And OpenWRT, which is the basis for Broadband Hamnet and AREDN and other projects, actually operates on that commercial equipment. So we felt it was time to transition to something that was much more contemporary with chip design and commercial Wi-Fi, and so we did. And so we initially started with the Ubiquiti AirMax line of gear, and that worked out really well, because not only do you get relatively inexpensive units that are weatherproof, that are designed to be powered over Ethernet, so you're just running one cable up and you don't have any coax losses for your RF links, because the radio and the antenna and the computer, in effect, are all up at the top of the mast or the top of the tower, out in the weather, wherever you have it. But they have a very flexible line, so it's not just one type of unit, but multiple units with varying power levels. And for the rocket units, you can get all kinds of different antennas, from a dual polarization Yagi to microwave dish antennas to sector antennas like you see on cell phone towers. So there's a lot of flexibility.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And that's what we started with, some of the nano products, those sector antennas. Yep. And I know a couple of the guys that have played around with and used the rockets as well. What is the advantage of using the AREDN software over the out of the box software that Ubiquiti puts on those?
Well, again, keep in mind that Ubiquiti software, like a lot of the commercial manufacturers, their software is also based on OpenWRT, and it's not it may not be as widely known, but it happens to be the case. And their target, their purpose is a little different than ours. Theirs is to sell to commercial wireless internet service providers who is widely known, but put this gear in the hands of their subscribers out in homes and offices, and it needs to be reliable and fairly simple to configure, but they're also designed for simple point-to-point links. Now, what we've done with AREDN and Broadband Hamnet before that is add additional package software on top of OpenWRT. The most important component is called Open Link State Routing, or OLSR, and that's the software that creates the mesh network. So when you power up a new unit, so if I take a little nano station like this, loco.
That's a loco, right? Right.
Yeah, this is the loco. This is the smaller one,
uh-huh.
Right? And if I power that up, and it's got the AREDN software on it, OLSR, among the other components, goes and starts querying the RF environment and looking for other nodes to connect to. And if it finds one, it actually establishes then an RF link. And this all happens automatically, typically within 20 or 30 seconds at most. And so that's something that the commercial interests are not overly interested in. It doesn't serve their business purpose as well, but it works great for an amateur radio operator that's trying to set up an emergency network.
So it's kind of the difference between idiot proofing and giving us the ability to do all the stuff that we would want to do. We wouldn't want that very simple idiot proof box that my business might want, that they just want to plug in, put on the wall, and never have to worry about.
Right. We're looking for a little more flexibility, but then again, our use cases are a little bit different too. So there's nothing to disparage one approach from the other. You just have to look at what is it I'm trying to accomplish here, and how do I best go about doing that.
Right. It's all about the mission.
It is. And typically the mission for emergency response is, how do I set up a high-speed, reliable network as quickly as I can with a minimum amount of fuss and effort, and yet not have to worry too much about the complexities of network routing and all of that. I just want to take a battery box and a nano station or two, tie-wrap them to a mast somewhere, maybe on the back of my pickup truck, and point them at some fixed node and say, here, I've temporarily got a high-speed node here down by the bridge where the floodwaters are rising. I need to hook a video camera to this, and we need to get the video of the rising floodwater back to the command post. And this is not going to sit out here all the time, but for the next 48 hours, this is something we want to watch closely, and we don't want to go to the effort of, say, posting a law enforcement officer out here in the rain for the next 48 hours on overtime watching this, when we can do this from the comfort of our emergency operations center. So that'd be one use case where putting up a temporary node would be of great benefit to the community.
Is this a similar technology to the home mesh that you get with, you know, say like an Eros, or I see that a lot being advertised, the home mesh networks to, you know, expand your coverage. Obviously, a significantly larger coverage area.
Yeah, I suspect it is. I've seen the ads for Eros and several others as well. I haven't dived into exactly how they're doing what they're doing, but given that all of this software that we're using and presumably they're using is all open source, it would surprise me if it wasn't very similar to what we're doing. But again, and there's nothing wrong with that. Again, they're you have to look at their mission and their goal and their use case, which is they're designing a product for consumers who are probably not ham radio operators, who probably don't have any technical training and are not interested in acquiring any. And so you really have to have a very simple, you know, plug and play kind of box that nobody's going to start reconfiguring. You know, they have one mission, and that's I want to be able to get extend Wi-Fi from wherever my primary access point is out to the patio and out to the garage and, you know, maybe halfway across my property if I've got a big piece of land, something like that. And I don't want to have to worry about, you know, how all this magic happens. I don't want to be able to have to run cables from one place to another. So, you know, if that's the use case, you know, that's probably a good way of going.
You're also not using as many channels, wireless channels, with the
well, there,
network,
yeah, there's
right?
that too. So you're also
using up all the bandwidth.
Yeah, and you're also using the, you know, the Part 15 channels, which again is an important distinction between what AREDN is doing and the commercially available stuff for consumers, the consumer yeah. approach. So while we are able to use, you know, some of the Wi-Fi channels under Part 97, on 2.4 gigahertz, for example, the channels 1 through 6 are also shared with ham radio. Oh, there you have the chart.
Yeah, the chart.
Yeah, you go to 1 there. So, but we've also been able to create what we're calling channel -1 and -2 that are exclusively in the ham band, so you don't have the interference from all of your neighbors' Wi-Fi routers, and it's made a huge difference in being able to create better throughput on 2.4 gigahertz equipment. But as the lower chart shows, we also can provide 24 channels on 3.4 gigahertz, and Ubiquiti and other manufacturers make 3.4 gigahertz equipment available, so that's a big help.
And those are primary ham frequencies, right?
They are. So so there's very low noise on those channels. The potential downside, if you go back, potential downside to 3.4 gig gear is while it's available, it's also a bit more expensive, at least in the United States. And the reason for that is because there really is no commercial market for 3.4 gig gear in the U.S. It's used elsewhere, I believe, in South America and Europe, perhaps, but not here. So the equipment's often sold by U.S. distributors, but it's marked for export only. But a ham radio operator can obtain the gear, as I've done very frequently, from several suppliers. Usually they require you to sign off on a document that says that you're duly licensed as a ham, you're responsible for operating this gear, and you're not going to use it in a way that contravenes the requirements of your license class. You know, they don't want to be held accountable, nor does the manufacturer, for misuse of radio gear and, you know, violating FCC regulations. So it's available, but it's typically available at somewhere between a 20% and 40% premium over the sort of the equivalent 2.4 or 5.8 gear.
And is it the same form factor? They have the Nano and the...
Yeah, it is. As a matter of fact, I've got one right behind me here. I don't know if you see this. This is a standard Nano station. Hold this on, one actually happens to be a 3 gig gear. And then here's the lower. This is the 2.4 gig loco.
Right.
The standard Nano station's sort of twice as long. And you can also get the rockets in 3 gig gear as well as 2.4 and 5.8.
Yeah, that's what the rockets
are. There's a couple of rockets with the two SMA connectors on the top of them, because there's actually two radios in there, and you then feed an antenna with both horizontal and vertical linear polarization, because it's a MIMO device. So you're getting both polarizations coming out of the unit at the same time. Mm-hmm. And
then there's the
channels. Yeah, 5.8 gig gear. So this is the largest amount of flexibility that you can get on the gear. And so you've got 52 channel choices, the top seven of which are again on a non-shared basis in the ham bands, and so this is again pretty remarkable. I mean, gives us a tremendous amount of flexibility in setting up both permanent and temporary networks on how we want to accomplish this. And it all depends on your local situation, what you're trying to achieve.
And that custom firmware is giving you access to these other channels. You're not going to get those channels with the stock firmware.
Well, that's correct. Yeah, that's correct. And clearly not to the ham bands, because, again, the commercial interests have no interest in providing access to channels that they can't use under their license class. I believe it's Part 90. Or Part 15.
So you talked about permanent or temporary deployments. One of the interesting things, I pulled up the map here, and it's what's cool is to see that it's spreading across the entire world, not just the United States. But I'll assume if we look at United States, and of course we're in California here. There's a lot of penetration going here. These are the permanent stations. Let's talk about the difference between, what you would do for a permanent backbone versus the temporary. You talked about that mission where, if the river's rising, you might want to set up a camera and a remote station there. What are some of the different missions you've seen or heard of that Arden's deployed in that temporary setting versus maybe what are the permanent positions?
All right. Well, let's talk about it's sort of under the heading of network architecture and how do you accomplish what it is you're trying to achieve. And of course, Southern California is one good example. Another is Tennessee, and we can talk about them in a moment. And there's several other locations, but Southern California has a very large and very active group of people across the lower eight counties of California, and then also rapidly growing around the Bay Area. But if we talk about the Southern California specifically, those eight counties have a population of something like 18 million people. And if I recall right, it's something like 16 million square miles. Is that right? Anyway, it's a lot huge. Of space.
A lot of space.
And a lot of people.
Yep.
So what the hams out there have done in working together with each other has set up both temporary and permanent infrastructure. And they're also, most of them are working very actively and very closely with a variety of served agencies at the municipal, county, and state level, both governmental agencies as well as private groups such as hospitals and the Red Cross and other disaster relief folks that might have some need for a backup high-speed communication network. And so in Southern California, they've established a lot of locations on the various high points that are accessible to them. Some of these mountaintops or hilltops already have a lot of commercial gear and towers on them. And with the longstanding relationships that local hams have had with the owners and operators of those sites, they've been able to position mesh nodes in addition to the more frequently found VHF and UHF repeaters. So you've got mesh nodes out there pointing across, say, from hilltop to hilltop. And if you're doing the hilltops, to think of that as sort of the backbone network. Often those backbone nodes are running on 3.4 gig gear, because while it's more expensive equipment, if you're only doing long distance across hilltops, you don't need as much of that. And because you're operating in a frequency band where there's very little or no interference from other services, you get tremendous throughput. So that's where the 3.4 gig gear often works the best and makes the most sense. And then so from hilltop to hilltop only tells part of the story. That doesn't do you much good except to talk to people on hilltop. What you need to do is get down the hills in the valleys. And so the second layer of the architecture is typically what's called a mid-mile point, where, let's say, theoretically, halfway down the hill, overlooking a particular valley, or perhaps even on the rooftop of a office block somewhere in the valley, you might have two or more nodes. One of the nodes in the mid-mile installation would point back to the hilltop, let's say on a 5.8 gig RF link, and that would establish your connection to the backbone. And then for the surrounding area, you might have another 5.8 gig node or more with sector antennas, or you might have 2.4 gig gear with sector or omni antennas that would provide access to the surrounding populated area in the valley. So this way you've got three layers. You've got a backbone on the mountaintops, you've got a mid-mile doing connections between the valleys and the mountaintops, and then you've got the local distribution either to permanent sites, let's say like a hospital or an emergency operations center, or to temporary sites that might be, again, mounted on a truck, or might be positioned on a mast that's held down with sandbags temporarily for some purpose, covering a parade, as I'd mentioned earlier, covering the floodwaters rising near a bridge, or getting close-ups of fires, of which there have been so many, so that kind of thing.
So sending video is one of those big...
Sending video is one of the very popular applications, and one of the very beneficial ones, for which, of course, you need a high-speed network. I mean, streaming video uses up a lot of bandwidth, so you're not going to be able to do that, say, with packet radio on UHF.
Right.
So you need some good quality and reliable connections and high speed band and bandwidth to do it. So video is often one of the first things that people think of. Another, of course, is backup for voice over IP telephony, mm-hmm. and of course of interest to a lot of folks for the reason that they may well have already experienced themselves cell phone outages. So you have that disaster, the fire, the earthquake, or the the flood due to hurricanes or snowstorms that have taken out power to the cell sites, and so your cell phone is all charged up, but it's got no place to go. And of course, our emergency responders also rely on Wi-Fi and cell phones. So if you can't talk to the people that are supposed to dispatch you or people that are supplying you with your needs, then you're just out of luck. So if you can stand up an emergency high-speed network that provides voice over IP telephony, you can keep people in touch doing what they need to do. And again, the goal is not to replace the commercial interests, but it's to help ham radio operators help the local community get through that first 24 or 48 hours when, you know, it's all gone down the chute and people are scrambling and yet, you know, lives and property are at risk. But if you can stand up this high-speed network and provide the ability for a responder to perhaps even use the cell phone in his pocket, but configure it ahead of time so you tell them to look for the AREDN mesh access point, because the operators have stood one of these up, and let's say the SSID is AREDN mesh and the password's AREDN mesh.
Right.
And in our last monthly training exercise at the Ares group for our county, we handed out little pocket cards, little laminated cards, that should you need it, it tells you how to connect your cell phone to an access point if one exists, and it has the telephone numbers for the emergency operations center command point, for the distribution center to where you get your water and your cots and your blankets, and it's got the phone number, say, for medical response. If you need help, and if you're in the shelter and you need help for a medical emergency, you can call directly to the the EMT people. So this is where an Ares group might take advantage of that and work not just with themselves, but again with their professional response community, and provide that backup when they need it the most. That critical 48 hours. Before Verizon and AT&T get their equipment back in service and running just fine. And
yeah, hence the emergency part of the AREDN name, right?
That's it. That's it. Well, that's we like to say AREDN is at the center of emergency preparedness. Mm-hmm. And I think we've got hundreds of ham operators who have implemented AREDN networks that are demonstrating that daily and doing a good job of supporting their communities.
Yeah, that's great. There's a map that I pulled up. I should probably show it if I'm going to talk about it. From the Ventura County.
Mesh?
Yeah, that has all these great links in addition that shows who's talking to what and where. And it really kind of helps to, illustrate that, if something happens up here in Ventura, that there are all these different pathways, not only locally, but to get your, connected out to Los Angeles and beyond.
Yeah, out of state. I see one going way off the map there at the bottom. I think that...
Now, there's a thing in here that talks about link cost. And I guess I can see there's some that are tunnels too. I guess the tunnels are internet points.
That's
they are. Yeah. Well, we can talk about tunnels for a moment. So the concept of a tunnel is to provide a means of linking, let's call them mesh islands, where at the moment it's infeasible to have a strictly radio frequency, an RF link between the mesh islands. And that may be for a variety of reasons. One may be just the distance. This is going across the country.
Right.
There may be a mountain range in between, and you haven't achieved critical mass yet with the number of hams interested in providing the services yet. So You've got some hams that are isolated from the larger community across, you know, on the other side of the mountain, but they want to participate. So you set up a tunnel, and the tunnel relies upon the internet being available. So tunnels do serve a purpose. They help introduce not only hams, but other served agencies to the concept of what an AREDN mesh network can do. So the tunnels provide that access for the purpose of training and familiarization and introducing the concept, showing the capabilities, what other people have implemented in terms of applications like telephony or streaming video or keyboard chat or file transfer or anything else you might do with an IP network. And so tunnels provide that kind of service. But we're also very careful to say that tunnels are not something that you really want to rely upon during an actual emergency response, because the internet may not be available to you. You know, if your access to the internet is, you know, through fiber or copper line or another RF link, the internet service provider's equipment may have failed due to the same disaster that you're trying to respond to. So you don't want to cut yourself off. So this is where hams on their own, through their own ingenuity and dedication and frankly a lot of time and money that they've personally put into this, you know, provide this sort of extra network that's available to the response agencies when they need it the most, when all the commercial network capability that they normally rely on is suddenly and more likely temporarily unavailable. So again, the goal is that if we can help get through that first critical 48 hours and let responders do what they do best in protecting lives and property, and be able to communicate with each other to perform their mission, then I think we've really accomplished something very worthwhile.
Yeah, absolutely. So we talked about the video. Is there any like two-way video products, or it's all one way at this point?
Can you Skype over it?
I'm not sure what you mean by.
So you know, one of the things that I often thought, you know, we support some races out here in Southern California, and it's all in the middle of nowhere, where there isn't any internet or backbone or any of those things, and we use the Ubiquiti products to get us connected back, and we track stuff via packet.
We just did this at AC100.
Yeah, AC100. And one of the things that they used to do was use ATV to do two-way between some stages. There's a stage. We work about 75 miles into the race, and then there's a stage about 8 miles back from us. And as runners are coming towards us, we used to have family members get in front of one end of the ATV, and folks on the other side get on the other, and they would talk back and forth with video.
Well, certainly you could accomplish that across an AREDN network too. Again, it's at the end of the day, it's just the high speed.
It's just the
IP network. So, right. You know, you can do if you have cameras at both ends. Clearly, you can talk. We've had a number of people that I'm familiar with that are very fond of using Grandstream video phones, and so there you might have a video conference using a sort of a desk set, if you want. So you don't need just a camera mount.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously you can go both ways. You'd mentioned races. I don't remember the organizers and participants to the effort, but since you're in Southern California, you're probably familiar with the Baker to Vegas race every year. Really quite a remarkable and huge event. I just found out about it last year. I'm out here on the East Coast in New Jersey, and I'm not familiar with it. But when I heard about it and started looking into it, I was completely blown away by what all the racers, and I believe these are all law enforcement people that are just out for a good time to raise some charity funds, I believe. And so there's been a group of ham radio operators that have been supporting communications for this event for quite
sorry, I'm on the wrong side here. I was trying to point at David.
To name one. Yes, yeah, about thank
my,
you.
This year was my seventh year.
See the bumper
year.
Stickers on the back of his car. Yeah.
B2B. Well, somewhere on our website, there's a nice reference to Baker to Vegas race for this past one, I believe this past spring. And the author wrote up a great description of what they were able to accomplish across, there we go, thank yep. you, mm-hmm. Across many of the stages. Not across the whole race course this year, but I think they're building toward that. And with a combination of AREDN mesh network and deployable cell on wheels, they call it a cow.
A cow, yeah.
From Verizon, they were able to provide streaming video and I believe voice telephony across some of the more interesting and critical parts of the race. So they're building out to that. So I'd recommend reading that article. I mean, it's really tremendously well written and an absolutely wonderful effort. I remember following some of the lead up to this about how the team was actually going out there on weekends months and months before the race event. And scouting out locations and doing some testing and, you know, doing what hams do, figuring things out. And some things worked, some didn't. So they came back another weekend and tried something different and, you know, learned from it.
Yeah, we, like I said, this year was my seventh year. And looking at the map here, you look on the left, this Ibex Pass.
Yeah, which were you guys at?
Well, Ibex Passes were the kind of the main... That's where they put the repeaters and the cow. There's a main kind of cow there, and I guess you can see where they were branching out the AREDN nodes. Where we work is up here at number 9 in the middle of Chicago Valley, which is literally these mountain ranges. You know, they look small here on this overhead, but they're big, and it cuts out all communications. We, for 2 or 3 years now, we've had a Verizon cow out there with us, mostly to provide support for the medical network. You know, the ham radio operators support race services, and you know, we you know, call in for supplies, and then we call in for medevacs and stuff like that. But the there's a requirement on the California side, and that's the line here, is the difference between California and Nevada, that the medical operators need to have a line to one of the local hospitals, and they've used the cows for that. They've used satellite, they've used some HF, and now they're trying out the AREDN stuff they did this year on a larger scale. And I think they made it from the finish line all the way, kind of, you can see out here, till about stage 6. They had stuff out there, and I know next year they're hoping to do more and more. We've talked about bringing it out there, but haven't had enough traction to get, you know, enough nodes and enough people at different stages to be able to do that. But this is good. I'll definitely link this article or this this page to the notes when the show's all done.
Oh, great! Thank you.
Yeah, it is a huge.
People
huge
should
endeavor.
Really again pay attention. The group that put this together, it just really need to be highly commended for the effort. Not just because they support, you know, the worthy cause of the Baker to Vegas race, but also for what they've learned and what they're passing along to other ham operators who might be interested in setting up an AREDN mesh network, and how you go about that, and some of the bumps in the road that you might hit as you go along, and how they overcame them. So it's a tremendous story from a variety of aspects.
Yeah, it is, and it's one we've covered here on the show before, and we'll continue to cover. So I want to talk about tools. So I know as these, you know, it's a backbone, right? And so we talk about, you know, mess chat. That's a great tool to be able to provide, you know, text communication back and forth. You talked about voice over IP. One of the things, the Antelope Valley area falls under our ARES section, and they Early on, we're using the Linksys routers and have upgraded to the Ubiquiti hardware and the AREDN stuff. And one of the things they did is they were taking Verizon prepaid cell phones that you can buy without service and having them in their communications toolbox. And when they put together their mesh connected to a backbone somewhere, they would hand those to the served agencies and say, you know, here's this VoIP application. I don't know if it was Vopier or Zello or one of those, and say, you know, it's already programmed with our different nodes and the other phones, and you know, you're the incident commander and you're in charge of this and you're in charge of that. You can use these phones. In addition to that, you can use our Astra system to dial out when we are connected to the internet. So there are folks doing this, and it's great. What are the other kinds of applications you've seen or heard of used for support or being supported by AREDN?
Well, one of the one you mentioned, it's the sort of the equivalent of IRC or keyboard chat. One of our team members, Trevor K7FPV, wrote an application called Mesh Chat, and that typically runs on a Raspberry Pi.
This is his website.
There's Trevor. Yeah. Trevor's bench. He's got a great website up there.
Uh-huh.
In fact, he's also got the down at the bottom of the page, you've got the portable internet mesh node. So he's got all kinds of that, and he's also got a build spec for a portable node that comes with a mast and how to hook it up and so on and so forth. So he's got to commend people to look at Trevor's website to get a lot of practical information on how to build some deployable nodes. Anyway, getting back to his application now. So he wrote MeshChat with the idea that we wanted a simple application that people didn't have to know anything about the network, but they want to communicate in writing and be able to save the messages and get them out across the mesh network where they need to be. And this is the application that does that very nice. I know another of our team members, Daryl, K5DLQ, who's in Montgomery County, Texas, just north of Houston. The Montgomery County ARES group, I believe, uses MeshChat for their monthly check-in exercises. So they run a net on MeshChat, and this keeps everybody fresh with how to communicate.
That's brilliant.
It is. I mean, well, you know, it's use it or lose it. You know, it's the same thing we always said, even with VHF and UHF voice. If you're not practicing, you know, at least once a month with how to properly check in, or better yet, run a directed net, your skills are going to get rusty, and you're not going to be able to use them when you need them. So why should this be any different? You know, whether it's a streaming video camera or a telephony network or a mesh chat, or you just want to be able to transfer some files from your remote site to the incident commander. You know, unless you practice those things every so often, you're going to forget how to do them and stumble when you're needed most. So that's where the ARES groups that are active and get together monthly. And it doesn't, again, with the high-speed network, it doesn't have to be face-to-face. You get together and practice these things and remind people how to do them. And it gives you an opportunity to introduce people that haven't done it before. You know, to lead by example and get them involved and get them interested in performing some useful services.
Mm-hmm.
So MeshChat's another big deal. I know that the telephony folks have done a lot of interesting things, including being able to hook up to commercial, you know, the public switch telephone network, say outside the affected area, so one can imagine how that would be of great service to responders in an affected area. How do I get out of out of my county or my multiple county area where We've lost all services due to the disaster, due to the hurricane that just came through. But if hams could provide a high speed network out 4, 5, 6 counties or halfway across the state, then we could get back out and reach our national organization perhaps.
And typically that just requires one node in the mesh to be connected to the internet backbone, right? To be able to route, ideally probably more, but that would be that one node.
Yeah, if that's what you were trying to achieve, all it would require is a minimum of one of the nodes that would be set up as a gateway to the internet. Mm-hmm. Now, normally, that wouldn't be done. Taking the Southern California example, I believe they have an agreement where none of the nodes is normally operating as a mesh gateway. It's not connected to the internet, and you don't want to do that if you don't want to introduce traffic to what would be considered a production emergency network that isn't related to your primary mission. So you need to be careful about doing those things. But it's like any other disaster response where you're responsible for communication. This is what are we trying to achieve here, and what's the minimum that we have to have in place to achieve that so it's reliable, and how do we keep all of the other distractions out of our communication network?
Right.
So it's the same sort of thinking that you would apply with any other sort of gear.
Got it. So what's your served agencies going to do?
Well,
when this stuff first came up in our organization, like on our Ares group, when we first started hearing about it, there were questions about encryption and
the legality of
the legality of that. And I don't know if this is stuff that you want to talk about or not. And we were never really clear. There are some that dyed in the wool. That some of the stuff that we could do if you're doing any internet protocol stuff, there's encryption, and encryption's a bad thing in ham radio. And I always thought, people are splitting hairs. What's your take on all that?
Well, I'm not going to get too much into it because, as you pointed out, it tends to be a very emotional issue and some very strongly held positions. And I'm certainly not going to want to create any more controversy or upset people about it. But I'd like to point out just a couple of items to at least consider. The first thing to consider is the language in the FCC regulations, as I understand it, and I may be wrong here, but my understanding is that some of that language really goes back to World War II and prior, and the concerns at the time were doing things like alerting the German U-boats off the East Coast here about where the oil tankers were sailing, that and where the convoys were assembling, that kind of thing, and so one can understand that you'd want to prevent any sort of leakage of sensitive information. And again, at the time, we weren't talking about high-speed microwave IP networks. None of that existed at the time. We were talking about Morse code over HF, and that was the high tech of the day. And it worked fine, and it was important to be sensitive about not having encrypted communications over those channels. So that's one thing to consider. Well, times have changed. And one other consideration before we leave this subject is that on a lot of the radio frequencies that we're using, both on 2.4 and 5.8 gig, if you operate on those radio frequencies under Part 97 as a ham radio operator, it appears that you're not supposed to use encryption. At the very same time, often using the very same equipment, but definitely on the very same radio frequencies, mm-hmm. your neighbor next door, who's not a ham, has no license, has no technical interest in what's going on, is operating a Part 15 device, and of course is ordering stuff from Amazon, right. doing his banking just fine, and goodness knows what else, all with encrypted radio communications on a Part 15 device on the same radio frequencies. So that is something else to ponder as well, and maybe we can just leave it at that.
Sounds good. Sorry to put you on the spot on that.
No, not a problem.
I did have a follow-up kind of question that's somewhat related, but not in a way. Security, you know, being that we are running these mesh networks unencrypted and with open source software and open passwords, is there a concern for, you know, the security that we've had to implement for our home networks with, you know, man-in-the-middle attacks and other things like that, that is something that we're worried about in the mesh community for hams?
Well, I don't know that worry would characterize it, but certainly concern, you know, a healthy concern for it, and probably more so than the, you know, the typical consumer who's, you know, stands up the Wi-Fi mesh router in their house or they has the AT&T or Verizon or Comcast person do it for them, and
right,
and you know, they kind of forget about it, you know,
and stock passwords and stuff like that,
and it never gets updated, you know,
right? No firmware updates.
So it's fine today, it's fine tomorrow, it's probably fine next month, but next spring, you know, there's been a whole flurry of compromises to that software that's built in or the firmware built into the mesh router or the Wi-Fi router, and the consumer doesn't know anything about updating it, wouldn't dream of attempting to do it even if they knew that updates were available.
Right.
So now you got millions of devices that are easily compromised. Well, clearly the people in the AREDN mesh community are concerned about those sort of things too. And among the development team, we're doing what we can to keep up as closely to the latest releases of OpenWRT, which is at the core of what we've got, and also be sensitive to, you know, the security patches that come out. And so that's why we're doing what we can to stay as current as we can. So the underlying open source software itself is as reasonably secure as anyone could hope it to be. So that goes a long way to help. And then there's, you know, the other aspect of actually running a deployed network, whether it's permanently installed or it's temporary or some combination of the both. And that's where each individual ham radio operator has to apply some thought to what they're doing. Again, you think about, we keep talking about, well, what's the mission? What is it you're trying to accomplish here? And so that's where familiarity with that mission and, more importantly, regular practice, again, through your local group, whether that's ARES or RACES or some other, you know, working with the county EOC, however it is you do it, that's where talking about and practicing providing communication for that mission identify areas of security concerns. And here's where I would really caution all of the ham radio operators that might be listening to this broadcast. It's one thing to think about your own internal needs because it's your network, your equipment. You've got a pretty good idea of things that could go wrong. It's probably even more important to listen to the personnel from your served agencies, whether they're a law enforcement officer or a medical technician or somebody at the Red Cross. Get to know them well and ask them what's important to them in what they communicate. What are they worried about? And I'm sure that once you have those conversations, there's a lot of interesting things that come up that you yourself wouldn't think of on your own, because you're not in that profession. You're not performing those jobs normally. You're a communicator or maybe a technologist and a ham radio operator, but you're not an EMT. So the things that EMTs communicate to each other are not in your normal scope of experience, and you need to understand what's important to them. And from that understanding of what's important come out aspects of, well, what needs to be secured and what doesn't? Where do we need to focus our attention?
Yeah, and I think that's, you know, overall, that's an important message for all the ARES folks and any operator that works with a served agency out there is what's the mission of the person that you're there to help, right? And I think that's often something that, you know, we say it over and over again, and sometimes it gets through and sometimes it doesn't feel like it does get through.
Right, and this is also an area where I think AREDN Mesh Networks have really helped ham radio operators gain a lot of credibility with the served agencies, because it's so vastly different from the old days of walking around with VHF and UHF handheld radios and shadowing, say, somebody that needed to communicate. With an AREDN mesh network, you can stand up this very modern 21st century high-speed network and work with people to communicate in the way they need to communicate. While ham radio operators may be providing the infrastructure, the communication network, we can do that and then get out of their way. Let the emergency responders communicate the way they need to, you know, without us, without a ham radio operator really holding their hand or being breathing down their neck, so to speak. You know, it's just here's the stuff you need to do your job. Go do your job.
And that's part of the most exciting thing about this kind of technology. You know, if we're just providing, you know, basic UHF, VHF, FM services to our served agency, we're like right in the middle of the message path, no matter what. You know, it's give me a piece of paper or tell me what you want to get there, and then I will get it to somebody on the other side and they'll get it to somebody else, and you're always playing operator. And by, you know, implementing this kind of stuff, you can actually hand them something. Here's a cell phone, or give me your cell phone, I'll program it. Now you have, you know, telephony, or you have the ability to chat, or you have all this other stuff. And I think that that's, I worry that there are some amateur radio operators that think, oh, you're putting in these tools to make us not necessary. But
no, you're an engineer now. You're more than just a communicator.
You can sit back and relax and say, yes, I'm going to provide you the service, but it's the service that they need and that actually I think that they want. If you talk to a lot of the served agency folks that I've talked to, most of the time when you ask them, well, what is it that you want and need? Most of the time what ends up happening is they do this. They'll tell you, I want this to work.
Yeah.
When it all hits the fan, I want this to work because I'm addicted, just like my kids. Kids and everybody else, we're addicted to these things and they want this to work.
I liked your earlier example of what to do with the inexpensive cell phone or your old cell phones. I've got a couple of them sitting right next to me here, an old Android cell phone that I haven't used in probably 4 or 5 years now, but I keep the battery charged up. Mm-hmm. And I've got a couple of voice over IP applications on there. I think Zoiper and Linphone and CSIP Simple are three that I recall. So you're right. And I like the idea. So really, local hams could gather up a box full of these things, probably from their friends and neighbors, possibly out of their own kitchen drawers. I mean, probably look around the house and you probably find half a dozen that you didn't have the heart to throw away. And set those up and get them all set up and programmed and take them to your next ARES meeting and set up a voice telephony network, get them all programmed. As I said, laminate some pocket cards that you can tape to the back of the phone and have them all charged up and ready to go, and then hand them out to your responders and say, you all know how to use a phone, don't you? Right. Of course you do. Well, here you go. This is already programmed where we don't even have to touch your phone or reconfigure it or do things that are going to worry you personally. But here's a phone just like the one you're familiar with using. The only difference is it's already, you know, pre-programmed to connect to an AREDN mesh network that's going to get you back to your command center or to your dispatch location. And bye. We'll be over there somewhere in the corner of the room. If you have a question,
that's right.
Ask. Otherwise, we're not getting in your way.
And I think that's key. And I know from talking to some of the members that there's a worry that they will work themselves out of a job. And I never see that would happen.
No. I don't. In fact, I think there's even more opportunity for ham radio operators in the 21st century with this kind of technical capability than ever before, because there's so much more that we can do with this and provide services to often the undermanned and often underfunded agencies that are doing so much to, again, to protect our lives and property. I mean, okay. and so if we can find ways of giving back, I'll give you one example that hasn't come to fruition yet, but I know several people were working on the idea of it. There's all kinds of applications that can and should be run across a high-speed network like this that would provide a lot of benefit to responders. And one of them is just being able to walk a neighborhood and do a survey of what's going on. What comes to mind is my youngest son, who was in the Marines during Hurricane Katrina back in, was it 2005, if I recall, was deployed down to the New Orleans area. And, of course, one of the things that the Marines and other groups of people did was literally drive through or wade through neighborhoods, checking on each dwelling, and then marking off whether people were there, was the place checked, what was the condition of it, and a variety of things like that. Well, fast forward now to later in the 21st century. Imagine if you had a person with a backpack with a decent 12-volt battery in the bottom of the backpack with an AREDN node on a little fiberglass stick on the back of it, and a tablet computer and a little access point that connected the tablet to the mesh node then to some other part of the network, and on the tablet is a survey application. So as you go from dwelling to dwelling, site to site, you're checking off on the application. It says, "Oh, okay, I've got an abandoned dog at this property, but no people." And okay, I've found here a lost child, or I've found an elderly person who's okay, but they need help getting transported out of the area. They don't move too good, or I need a medical response team right here, right now, and I can show you. I can from my tablet. I can do a video of the condition here. There's a cut on the forearm here. This is what we're up against. I can help you triage right from the site even before you get here. So you can by the time you get here in your vehicle and you open the door, the responder already has the bandages or the medicine or the gear in their hand as they're coming out the door, and you cut another 30 seconds off that response. So, you know, those kind of applications running across a high-speed network back to people that make those command decisions could be really invaluable to the response community. And this is not something that they necessarily have the time or the interest or the capability of developing themselves. And if they did, you know, they may not be able to afford it. And this is where, again, hams have readily come to the fore and provided hundreds of hours and thousands of dollars in support of their local communities.
You let the first responders focus on being good first responders and make the tools easy for them to use.
Yeah, well, you know, I people have asked me about that. Somebody had asked me about that at Hamvention this year and last year. And I said, you know, in some ways, I kind of look at it as enlightened self-interest. By that, I mean, I personally am very interested in making sure that the local responders here in my community in northern New Jersey, you know, have the equipment, have the funding, have the capability of responding to emergencies in my area. Why? To protect my life and my property. Okay, and I'm not an EMT. I'm not a firefighter. I'm not a law enforcement official. I'm not one of those people that can do those jobs. And of course, like most people in the area, and certainly most hams I know, you know, we all throw a little something in the hat every year when the envelope comes around and says, you know, please support your local ambulance corps. And so we write them a nice check, and it goes in the mail, and we'll do that every year. But, you know, as hams, we can do so much more. Besides just writing check, we can provide our communications skills and our communications infrastructure and give them that backup capability that they would never find or fund on their own. And this gives them that little bit of extra that, again, I think is enlightened self-interest. It helps them protect me and my family and my neighbors and their families by giving them that extra capability to get them through the really tough times when that disaster is just has stricken the area and knocked out all of their primary communication facilities.
Yeah, absolutely. I pulled up your area. This is the area where you're in on the map there.
It is, generally, yep.
You got good 2.4 coverage mostly.
Well, that you're just looking. You'd have to zoom in. This is if you zoom in right on my location.
Got it. Oh yeah. There's
I've got a. It's where the little blue dot over by Westwood over there. If you have to zoom all the way in, I've got a whole bunch of nodes that
they're all on top of each other.
Further in there. there
it is.
Hey, look, there you are.
there I am.
Wait for the camera.
There I am, folks. Yeah, it's Whiskey Uniform 2 Sierra. That's where I'm located. And, of course, part of the reason I have a lot of nodes here is I do a lot of testing for the team. So while I don't have a lot of capability of writing the software, I this is how I started getting involved with the team back in the broadband hamnet days, is testing the software, and I can continue to do that.
So you test a lot of the software on the different. I pulled up the page of the covered devices. So you say you're testing the software, that's like new revisions on the currently supported stuff, and then new software on new hardware as well.
Yeah, exactly. Uh-huh. So there's sort of a mix of equipment here. So the largest set of equipment is at the top, say, two-thirds of the chart,
right?
And that's the Ubiquiti AirMax line. And again, it's a wonderful product line. I mean, it's just there's so many different things that you can do with it. As I'd mentioned before, it's weatherproof, and you feed it with power over an Ethernet cable. So all you do is run a single cable up to the unit and position it where you want, and a variety of antenna types and a variety of power levels. And then the second set of gear is by TP-Link, and that's the CPE 210 and CPE 510 gears, and they look very similar to the nano stations. That's sort of long rectangular gear. They're a little less rounded, but other than that, the same similar sorts of plastic containers that are made to be weatherproof. And then the latest thing that the development team has been working on is porting the code over to MikroTik gear. And that's a third commercial vendor that's very popular among wireless internet service providers, very high quality gear. And we've been looking to provide some manufacturer or vendor diversity, as it will, so we're not, we, the larger AREDN community, is not solely relying on a single vendor. And this way, we can protect our investment in gear, and over time, as capabilities change and as vendors drop support for their legacy equipment, we all have places to go and the capability of replacing that gear. But the MikroTik gear, we've got code operating on that now as I speak. It's not quite ready for prime time for general release, but and it's a little bit challenging to install at the moment. But we've got a couple of people operating it now. I don't personally yet, but I'll be getting some MikroTik gear sometime in the next couple of months and helping out with the testing on that as well.
Well, it's good to see you're expanding it into new hardware, because, you know, there's that concern that what happens if Ubiquiti starts locking you out or changing the way the hardware is made, and we run out, just like we did. We ran out of the Linksys boxes, and I know I have four or five of them that I purchased over the years on eBay, you know, for anywhere between, you know, $5 and $25.
I think you can still get them some places.
You can, but a lot of times what you get is the wrong model numbers, because over time they shrunk the memory and you can't put them on some of those models.
Right. Well, if you're really that interested in Linksys, I think I've got about a dozen downstairs.
That's what I was going to say. I think they're hiding around everywhere.
Yeah, I think we're off that now.
I noticed that Linksys is not on your list, though.
No, it's not. No, and it wasn't from the beginning, and the again,
because I know Broadband Hamnet you can still load onto Linksys.
If you have Broadband Hamnet running on a Linksys box, which of course is 2.4 gig only, you can have that Linksys box communicate with an AREDN 2.4 gig piece of gear. But only on channels 1 through 6, not on -1 or -2.
Yeah, I noticed my Linksys won't go to -1 or -2 either. So
you can't. Well, again, that's what we were just talking about. So that the chipsets become obsolescent after a time, and the chipsets that are running the Linksys gear are not capable of moving there. Also, the Linksys boards really don't have a lot of memory in them as well, and that was another limitation, that in order to do some of the things we'd like to do, we need more memory, and a lot of the more contemporary equipment has much, much more memory on just the sort of the standard Wi-Fi router, so we're able to do a lot more with it. And of course that changes, and so today's 2.4 gig nano station, I don't know, 8 or 10 years from now, it'll have we'll look at it and laugh and say, well, gee, that chipset is really way past its useful life. It's still running, but wow, that's really an antique, and we're doing so much better today. So
I'll be scouring eBay for them then.
Yeah. Well, I've been reading.
Well, I'll probably have a bunch of them ready to sell to you.
I bet you will.
I was reading with the there's a Groups.io for AREDN, and there was a lot of discussion recently about memory and some of the new firmware not fitting on some of the older devices. I think that got all sorted out. Anyways,
yeah, that's a real concern. It's one that we've had internally, and of course now we've had broadened the discussion externally outside the development team, and we want to make sure that the broader community understands that we want to be careful about maintaining support for the existing devices that everyone's invested so heavily in, and a lot of them don't have as much memory as the newer devices. A lot of the older Ubiquiti devices, for example, have 32 meg of memory, right. and many of the current equivalent devices have 64 meg, which gives us a lot more flexibility. But we don't want to drop the support for the older ones. But what may happen over time, and we're still not settled on this, is as we extend capabilities or add features, let's say, the older devices, the more legacy devices, may not get the additional feature sets, but they would still maintain capability with the entire supported product line.
Have a fork of the operating system for the legacy devices versus the
new ones, I guess
potentially
it's more that the higher capability devices are getting the extended capabilities, and the older devices have stabilized on sort of the existing stable set of features, but they're not getting the next set of features.
And that seems like, you know, that's where the hamnet broadband kind of got, I don't want to say left or stopped, but that, you know, it made it to a certain point. And as you said, they're still usable, and they provide some value here or there. I had one in my truck for a while when we were starting to play around with it, because you can power it off at 12 volts, and that was kind of cool. And
You can power all this Ubiquiti gear off at 12 volts too, and we had that. But you're right. This is no. I wouldn't throw all my Linksys gear away just yet for anyone that's listening, because again, it's the type of thing that is very useful and very helpful in introducing people to the concept of mesh networking, right. and so you may have folks in your area, in your club, in your Aries group, or just hams you run into that start asking you, well, what's all this about? What can you do with it? And, you know, what would it take to get started? Well, I might be a little reluctant to lend somebody, a box full of nanostations, right off the bat, particularly when I may not know them, but I probably wouldn't think twice about saying, this is, well, here's a couple of Linksys boxes that I've already pre-configured to work just fine on mesh network, and I've got them running on channel 1, so they will talk to my Ubiquiti nanostation over here that I've also got running on channel 1, and I can demonstrate that for you. How about you take these things home with you and play with them for a couple of weeks or a month, and then come back and tell me what you thought about it, or as you're doing this, let me know what challenges you've run into. Were you able to get your computers hooked up to it? What problems did you run into? Get familiar with, it's a real mesh network with two, or maybe I'll give you three or four of the darn things. And if I never see him again, it's probably no loss.
Right. That would be what my wife would say. Yeah. Right, more stuff out of the garage.
But more likely, the ham that I gave him to has a wife like mine. And
Yes.
She says, well, when are you going to get rid of those blue things? Give them back to Randy.
Right.
And we pass them along to somebody else and see if we can get somebody else involved in the idea. So once again, it says, you repurpose stuff, get people involved, or take them to a high school where there might be a radio club, and here you go. This is you don't like what's going on the internet, kids? No problem. Ham radio has the answer. Set up your own private internet. Well, there you go.
Sounds good.
Can do it.
We're all carrying radios these days, whether they're our cell phone or our. All the kids have got them.
Absolutely,
yeah.
Absolutely.
Hey, you got to remind them. This is right. They're already communicating with high-speed microwave networks.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. The ones they're communicating with, though, are owned by Verizon or AT&T or, T-Mobile or something like that. And says, well, okay, but here you can own your own high-speed multimedia microwave network, and I'm going to give you a box full of Linksys routers and show you how to hook them up. Maybe run them off a wall wart or a 12-volt battery, go to it, kids. You're now your own wireless internet service provider.
Right. Very cool. Very cool.
Instagram over mesh network.
Yeah, absolutely.
There you go. Why not? Yeah.
So we're getting to about the hour and a half point. Is there anything that we didn't think of to ask you that you want to make sure folks know about?
Well, clearly the best part of our ardenmesh.org website is the community and all the activity that goes on. It's called the forum, and I'd like to call attention to that, because in addition to the typical things that you'd find on any community forum, you know, general discussion and then some specifics about hardware or deployment, applications, that kind of thing. We've also got a number of areas that we have regional forums where people want to do a little more focused keeping in touch with their local areas. And so as people have requested it, as they've developed a critical mass for their area of the world, we've set up little sub-forums for them.
Yeah, I saw California had a few sub-forums there.
Yeah, yeah. And this is all, you know, at external request from the community. I'm not dreaming these things up. So people can keep in touch and talk about things that are important to them. The community is very active. We're typically seeing 80 to 100 messages a week or so. And the website makes it easy to keep up with all of this stuff as each individual chooses to do so. So if you register at the ardenmesh.org website, after you register, you can choose to subscribe to a variety of communication. You can choose to subscribe to whether or not you get an alert if there's a new news article or an announcement that comes up, or there's a posting to a particular forum that you're interested in. So if you're in Southern California, maybe you want to see any new messages that have to do with Orange and Ventura counties only, because that's of primary interest to you, and you don't want to get a lot of email alerts from things that are not of interest to you. So you have a lot of choices in keeping in touch. But the community is very active, and we're very grateful to the things that people supply. We saw that wonderful example of the Baker to Vegas race and how they arranged all of that. I also want to call attention to a very big event taking place this week. In fact, I believe it starts this afternoon in Tennessee, just outside of Nashville. If you go to the front page on the and scroll down the front page a little bit to the announcements, there's an announcement about a conference and an exercise in Tennessee, the Tennessee Public Safety
Interoperability
event. And that's going on right now in Smyrna, Tennessee, I believe. At this event, there are people like Tom Delker, K1KY, and a variety of local hams who are demonstrating the capability of Arden Mesh Networks to Tennessee public safety officials and responders. And from talking to Tom over the last several months about this, there's a tremendous support from the Tennessee state and county governments, as well as the Tennessee Emergency Management Agency and the Tennessee National Guard. And as I understand it, there are plans that are being discussed to link up a variety of Tennessee National Guard armories and hospitals and emergency management facilities all across the entire length and breadth of Tennessee with the high-speed Arden mesh network. Obviously, that's going to take some years to accomplish, but they've already made a pretty good start on it, and that's one of the things they're talking about at this conference this week. So a lot of interesting activity taking place there in the middle of the country.
Excellent. Excellent. Well, we'll look forward to seeing some information out of that if it's there. Well, I want to thank you so much for joining us. I think this was great. I think this gave everybody a great idea about how this all works and how you could get up and running and lots of resources. We keep talking about it in our area's organization, and I know we're getting closer and closer to it.
We got two of us.
Yeah,
actually three. I'd say we got a few more.
Yeah, I know there's a couple of them already out there.
If I could make just a quick pitch before we go.
Yep, absolutely.
And that's a pitch to help support the AREDN project itself. And I know I've talked about this a couple of times. We've had it in press releases that in the ARRL and other places, but through your channel, I'd like to make the pitch again. We can't do this all by ourselves. We've got a fairly small and very active team of people that have been moving this project forward for the last 3.5 years. And we're slowly but steadily expanding. We've got, again, a community of active deployment and testing people that are absolutely wonderful in helping. But there's other needs that the AREDN project has. And, of course, among those are first and foremost people who might be interested in helping with developing the firmware itself. And so this requires a familiarity with OpenWRT and Linux and firmware development and, of course, an interest in doing so. So that's sort of one group of people that we need. We need people that are interested in helping test the firmware as it comes out and are willing to spend the time and effort testing on a variety of equipment, not just the most common equipment. We need folks to write more applications for making an AREDN network more useful. I gave the example of a survey type applications, but there's a lot of other things that need to be done, and the only way we know what those are is by having conversations with and listening carefully to the emergency responders that we are interested in supporting. Ask them what kind of things would they most need if all of their communication applications were suddenly unavailable for 24 to 48 hours. What is the number one and number two thing that they would need in the way of communications applications? And those are the things that we'd like to see developed and deployed. And of course, we need some help with administrative things like helping run the website and making it better and making it a better vehicle to communicate with people and get the words out. We're kind of doing this all on our own, but it often helps to have another set of eyes and another set of fingers on the keyboard, writing up some articles, doing some proofreading, helping us with website maintenance, that kind of thing. So
and how,
those are the types of skill sets we're looking for.
And how do our watchers and listeners get to you?
Well, that's real easy to do. You can certainly communicate with me directly via email, whiskeyuniform2sierra@ardenmesh.org. If you're already registered on the website, you can communicate by just clicking the link under my wonderful picture with the on any of my postings. It'll set up an email message. And so that's probably the best way of communicating with us. And if it's something that I can't deal with directly, I do the triage and dispatch it to the rest of the team and let people who really know what they're talking about do their jobs the best they can.
Do you guys have any like Patreon or GoFundMe or any of those things for donations?
Not yet, but thank you for asking. We're just about to start that, and that's and again, one of the reasons that we set up a corporate structure. AREDN Inc, Amateur Radio Emergency Data Network Incorporated, is a 501c3 corporation registered in the state of New Jersey. And we have our 501c3 determination from the IRS, so we're legitimate. Great. And we will start making pitch for funding. Again, for the last 3.5 years, we've been doing all of this out of our own pockets. And while we're happy to do so, as I told the team recently, it says, all of these things eventually come to an end. I might be getting better looking every day, but I'm not getting any younger. Yeah. And and the funds aren't going to last forever either. So we'd like to get some help from the rest of the community to the extent that they would be willing to do so.
Well, reach out and let me know when there's an easy way to get that to you, and I will definitely put it up either on our Facebook page, and I'll talk about it on the show.
Right. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So this was Ham Radio Now, episode number 401, and thank you again, Randy, for joining us. If you like what we're doing and you want to support us, you can visit hamradionow.tv, watch an episode, or you can find Arvin, our chief financial officer, and click the pig and share some love with us. It's the same thing as the AREDN folks. I'm doing this pretty much by myself. I get some help every once in a while, and it's all in the garage. And so whatever you can do to help me out, it all goes into hosting and equipment and other stuff to support the show. So thank you very much. Randy, you've probably never watched a show before.
I watch it fairly frequently, David.
Well, good.
Thank you for the wonderful work that you do.
So you know how we end the show? You ever get to the end?
I don't remember.
Okay,
no.
you'll know when we get to the end. Yeah. There's three words you use to close it out. I'll start it. Darren will take the second word, and you'll figure out the last of the words. This was Ham Radio Now, episode 401. Over
and
out.
Perfect. And that AREDN thing should have played now. Or not. I'm going to clear it off.
Fade to black.
And fade to black. So that was great. Thank you so much.
Yeah, that was really great.
I will.
Thank you.
I will post this up. We are still live on the Facebook room.
Hi, Facebook.
Hi, Facebook. Thanks for joining us. I will post this up, and as soon as it's up, and hopefully by the end of today, it'll be posted and online. I'll send you a link, and feel free to share it with anyone and everyone. If you want to put it on the AREDN page, that would be awesome. And
absolutely, that's the first thing I want to do, is put it right on the front page.
Perfect.
Thank you.
Great. If there's late and breaking, important, exciting news, just feel free to reach out to me anytime. I am always hungry for content. So
yeah, I know the feeling.
be happy to support you guys.
We're in the publishing business too.
I know we've been talking about. I have some equipment here. I think I bought a newer grid than you guys support. But I have some of those nanos, and we're working on getting them up. Unfortunately, I live in a little valley.
Yeah, me too. I have the same problem.
There's just nothing you can see. But we're working on at least deploying them. Now that we're starting to ring the San Fernando Valley, I'm starting to make sure every time we go out and we put something up that I can put a mast on the back of my truck and at least talk to it in some way, shape, or form.
Yep.
Yeah, it was really helpful at AC 100. I think it was the only way we were able to communicate to the other stage there. So,
it's a big
very
deal.
Cool, very cool. Well, I hope you guys are able to get more involved with mesh networking in your area too. It really looks like Southern California is growing by leaps and bounds.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. We're talking to Orv Beach and
he's one of our strongest proponents out there. He's very active. He's definitely the right guy.
He's been out to talk to Arias Group a couple times, and we're working on getting him some funds and some places to put stuff. So
he's trying to get me set up with tunneling right now, because I'm in a little valley myself and have no service there.
All right, cool. I'm gonna turn off the stream again. Thank you so much, and I'll look forward to speaking to you again in the future.
Thanks for the opportunity. Really appreciate it.
Yep. Thank you. 73.
73.